One False Move by Robert Goddard. Read by Fiona Hampton and Alistair Petrie. Carl said I was absolutely the right person for this job. I think he meant it. He didn't actually say it was a job for a woman, but I could tell that's what he thought. The target was probably male and probably young. Goes with the territory. So, send me. I wanted to go. I leapt at the chance, in fact. Not just because it promised to put my career back on track after my transfer to London, but because it really was fascinating. Who was this guy? And yes, like Carl, I felt sure all along it was a guy. When I was shown what he could do, I wanted to talk to him. I wanted to understand. We could exploit his abilities to put Venstrom ahead of the competition. Of course, that was always the commercial calculation. But beyond that, how he did what he did was an irresistible and unfathomable mystery. Carl didn't know what he was getting us into, of course. He couldn't. No one could. There's nothing to warn you when you cross an invisible line. But the other side soon starts to feel different. And in this case, not so very long after different, dangerous. So this is what happened beyond that line. This is what happened as it happened. This is how I got to where I am. Monday, October 7th. I linger over breakfast. There's no hurry. The hotel's quiet, ticking over this early in the week, this late in the season. The weather's mostly grey, but silvery light keeps piercing the clouds over the sea. There's no wind. I gaze out through the high windows of the restaurant and see a couple of bulk carriers moving slowly out beyond St. Anthony Head, heading to or from Falmouth. The view here in St. Maur's is serene and beautiful, the sea tranquilizingly still. I catch myself thinking how nice it would be to be here on holiday, and how much nicer again to be here on holiday with the right person. I used to think I knew who the right person was. Now I haven't a clue. And I'm not on holiday either. It's just me here, with a job to do. I sip my coffee and check my phone. No alert yet. He isn't playing. But he will be. Soon. All we know for certain about our mystery man is that the IP address of the computer he's using leads to Conrad Vogler of Admiral's Reach, Upper Castle Road, St. Maur's, Cornwall. And all we know about Conrad Vogler is his directorship of a company called Conmari Limited, nature of business, unspecified, and his date of birth, July 2nd, 1970, which makes him too old to be an obvious candidate. The other director of Conmari Limited is Marianne Vogler, presumably his wife. The company name seems to be a tacky pairing of Conrad and Marianne, which doesn't make me warm to them. But a super geek son of theirs could well be our guy. We're betting on that. The Voglers don't have much of a presence in the virtual world, in fact, none at all, which could make some people suspicious. Venstrom has grown as huge and successful as it has by offering people solutions to problems they didn't know they had, by selling them goods and games and all the vital ingredients of the virtual lives we lead. So, to me and my colleagues, who don't just like but need to know as much as we can about our customers, the disconnected are either dinosaurs or people with something to hide. And somehow, the Voglers don't come across as dinosaurs. I took a look at Admiral's Reach straight after I arrived yesterday evening. Modern, white-walled, slate-roofed, with plenty of glass and steel, all hard angles and blank surfaces, set in a big, gently sloping plot a little way up the hill from St. Maur's Castle. Most of the windows were lit. There was a big four-wheel drive pulled up in front of the garage. Someone was evidently at home. I didn't try my luck then. Our guy never plays at night. He's a daytime-only player, If I'm just going to show up at the Vogler's door, and I can't think of any other way to approach them, I want it to be while he's online. It'll be more difficult for them to deny it then. I'll have something to show them. I put my toe in the water with an email before leaving London, inviting Konmari Limited to contact us for some free website design advice. No response. Which leaves nothing for it but the face-to-face approach. Carl didn't give me any bright ideas about how to pitch it. I think I'm just going to have to charm my way in and see where we go from there. I'm a bit nervous. And I'm very curious. I suppose, most of all, I'm excited. I've just no idea what I'm going to find. My phone beeps just after 10. He's on. And so am I. I don't want to turn up so close to him starting to play that he'll make a connection. So I leave the hotel and walk past the harbour, rehearsing a whole load of ways I can introduce the subject without alarming him. The ferry from Falmouth is docking. A few late holidaymakers are clambering off and climbing the steps to the quay. No one gives me a second glance. I'm wearing a navy blue trouser suit and white blouse under my Mac. I look like I mean business. I've applied a touch more makeup than usual. Nothing obvious, though. Just enough to make me difficult to turn away. This isn't necessarily my only chance, but it might be my best one. I plan to make the most of it. I walk down the curving drive to the front door of the house. The 4WD is gone, and there's a battered Fiat parked in its place. The grounds are terraced, falling away towards Lower Castle Road. I'm imagining a panoramic deck and big sea-facing windows on the next level down. There's not much to see on this side of the house. I check my phone. He's still on. His sessions generally last an hour or two. I ring the doorbell and wonder just what kind of reception I'm going to get. Half a minute or so passes. The door opens. A woman in jeans and a t-shirt looks out at me. She's too young to be Marianne Vogler. My money's on her being the cleaner. When she speaks, it's with a local accent. And I don't have the Voglers down as local. "Hello," she says. "I'm looking for Mr. or Mrs. Vogler. They're out." "Ah, right." This isn't necessarily bad news. Is any other member of the family at home? "It's just Mr. and Mrs. Vogler who live here." That isn't quite an answer to my question, I notice. "You can leave a message if you want." "Right, thanks. My name's Nevinson, Nicole Nevinson. Can you give Mr. and Mrs. Vogler my card?" I hand one over. She glances down at it. "I contacted them recently about a business opportunity, and I happen to be in the area, so..." She looks unimpressed. I can't really blame her. "I'll tell him you called." A tight smile. She starts to close the door. "Lovely house," I say, brightly. "Yeah. I bet the views from the front are amazing." She frowns. "They are. But it's obvious there isn't going to be any invitation to take a look. I've got to get back to work." "Of course, but..." "Yeah? When do you think Mr. and Mrs. Vogler will be back?" "Dunno for sure, but Mrs. Vogler will probably be here this afternoon." "Okay," I smile. "I'll try then." "Okay?" The door closes. I walk slowly back up the drive, asking myself whether that was a total screw-up or just a minor setback. I can try again this afternoon. I'll have to. I check my phone. He's still on. And Kyra has texted me the GPS report. He's in St. Moore's. Most likely, I reckon, inside Admiral's Reach. I glance back at the house from the road, then head off towards the castle. I wander around the galleries and trinket shops. I drink another coffee. I have an early lunch and try to put my plans in order. There's a lot riding on this. Though, since Venstrom's resources are massive, I really should be able to make an offer that's too good to refuse. The rest is just presentation. He stops playing while I'm having lunch, so I decide to go back to the house. Even though he's no longer online, I have enough to go on. A few spits of rain are in the air as I walk along Lower Castle Road. There are houses and cottages to my left, facing the sea. To my right are high hedged banks bordering the gardens of the big houses in Upper Castle Road, one of them Admiral's Reach. There are steps up to back gates concealed by undergrowth. I wonder which one might lead to Admiral's Reach, and whether it's worth going up to take a look. Suddenly, a young man appears, jogging down the nearest flight of steps. He's tall and slim, with a mop of dark hair and a pale, narrow face. He's dressed in jeans, t-shirt, and retro corduroy jacket, and is carrying a bulging leather shoulder bag. I notice how long his fingers are as he pushes one hand through his hair. Is he my guy? I look at him as he turns and strides off in the direction I came from, back into town. I don't have long to think about it, but he ticks all the boxes. Age, sex, appearance. The consensus, based on his online behaviour, has always been that he'd turn out to be someone like this. Yes. I follow, 10 meters or so back. Carl's last words to me as I left his office last Friday were, "Good luck." Well, I've just got lucky. This is my guy. I'm sure of it. He walks fast, head nodding, maybe in time to music.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.